الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ومن اهتدى بهداه إلى يوم الدين. All praise due to Allah, and we ask Allah to send the peace and the blessings and exalt the mention of Prophet Muhammad, his companions, and all those who follow them on the righteous path until the day of judgment. Brothers, we continue with the book of Al-Aqidah Al-Wasitiyah li Shaykh Al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, the Sharh of Muhammad bin Salih bin Uthaymeen rahmatullahi alayh. And we are currently dealing with the statement of Ibn Taymiyyah, where he said about speaking about Allah Azza wa Jal, فَإِنَّهُ أَعْلَمُ سُبْحَانَهُ بِنَفْسِهِ وَبِغَيْرِهِ وَأَصْدَقُ قِيلًا وَأَحْسَنُ حَدِيثًا مِنْ خَلْقِهِ. Verily Allah knows better about himself, glory be to him, and about others, and he is more truthful in speech, and he is better in explaining than his creation. The Shaykh rahimahullah said, قال المؤلف رحمه الله هذا تمهيدا وتوطئة لوجوب قبول ما دل عليه كلام الله تعالى من صفاته وغيرها. He said, this is an introduction by the Shaykh, may Allah have mercy on him, in order to prepare us mentally for the obligation of accepting whatever the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal indicates pertaining to his attributes or otherwise. وذلك أنه يجب قبول ما دل عليه الخبر إذا اجتمعت فيه أوصاف أربعة. So that means, and that is, that we must accept whatever the information contains, يعني whatever the ayah or the hadith, if four qualities are present. We need four things to be present for us to accept this particular thing. And the Shaykh explained why. الأول أن يكون صادرا عن علم وإليه الإشارة بقوله فإنه أعلم بنفسه وبغيره. First, that information must be based on knowledge. It must be based on knowledge. And this is why it is mentioned that the Ibn Taymiyyah said, Allah has more knowledge about himself and about his other than him, يعني his creation. والوصف الثاني عفوا الصدق. The second quality is truthfulness. And he indicated that by saying وأصدق وأشار إليه بقوله وأصدق قيل. And he is more truthful in speech. الوصف الثالث البيان والفصاحة وأشار إليه بقوله وأحسن حديثا. The first is clarity in delivering the message and eloquence, فصاحة. And this was indicated when the Shaykh said وأحسن حديثا, Allah is better in speech. والوصف الرابع, the fourth quality, سلامة القصد والإرادة. The clarity and the soundness of the intention. Okay, basically the objective behind your speech. What is the objective behind your speech? This is relevant. So if the objective, for instance, as it is in the case of the Quran, is to guide the people, then inevitably you must take whatever is in it, because the objective behind it is a guide. It's a form of, it's a guidance for humans. بأن يريد المخبر هداية من أخبرهم, that the one who's informing us must want guidance for those who've been informed. But فدليل الأول, then he will give evidence from the Quran for each one of these. فدليل الأول وهو العلم, the first evidence, which is knowledge. He must be more knowledgeable of himself. وهو قوله تعالى, قوله تعالى وربك أعلم بمن في السماوات والأرض ولقد فضلنا بعض النبيين على بعض وآتينا داود زبورا. سورة الإسراء verse 55, Allah عز وجل says, interpretation of the meaning in English, and your Lord is more knowledgeable of that which is in the heavens and the earth, and we have favored some prophets over others, and we have given David the Psalms, the Zabur, just translated as the Psalms. So Allah said, وَرَبُّكَ أَعْلَمُ. Your Lord, أَعْلَمُ is ism tafdeel. We will see what that means. More knowledgeable. It usually comes when there's comparison. You say, هُوَ أَكْبَر. He is bigger. Okay? أَصْغَر. And what have you from these words? أَحْلَى, أَطْيَب. More sweet. More better, more delicious. Always this form of the language, this form of a noun, indicates favorism, to favor something over the other. So Allahu A'lam, meaning Allah knows best, knows more knowledgeable. فهو أعلم بنفسه وبغيره من غيره. So Allah Azza wa Jal knows more about himself. I mean, nobody's going to know. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. No one can encompass any of the knowledge of Allah. The one that, except what He wills to give us. Otherwise, His knowledge and whatever is pertaining to Allah is beyond us. Unless we have been given revelation. So we know Allah Azza wa Jal through the revelation. Anything beyond that, no access. No human being has any access. But Allah knows that which we do not know. فَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِكَ مِنْ نَفْسِكَ. Furthermore, Allah knows more about us than ourselves. Shaykh said, Allah knows more about you than you. You think you know yourself, you really don't know yourself as much as Allah knows you. Because He created you and He allows you to function in the way that you function. لِأَنَّهُ يَعْلَمُ مَا سَيَكُونُ لَكَ فِي الْمُسْتَقْبَلِ وَأَنْتَ لَا تَعْلَمُ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدَى. Because Allah knows what will happen to you in the future. And you don't even know what you will earn tomorrow. That's reality. وَكَلِمَةُ أَعْلَمْ هُنَا إِسْمُ تَفْضِيلٍ. The word أَعْلَمْ here is a noun of favoring. It's rough translation. Basically, as I mentioned, whenever you favor something, it begins usually with Alif Hamza. أحسن, أقوى, أفضل, أكبر, and what have you. Favoring something over the other after doing some comparison. Say, you know, he's good, who is good, but هو أفضل. He is better. You see what I'm saying? That's when this word comes. So the Shaykh said, وَلَقَدْ تَحَشَاهَا بَعْضُ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Some of the scholars did not like it, this particular term. And they said, why? فَسَّرَ أَعْلَمُ بِعَالِمٍ. They said, أَعْلَمَ, أَعْلَم means, means عَالِم, knowing. Not more knowledgeable. They took away the meaning of more knowledgeable, which indicates favoring. And they said, Allah is just knowing. Kept it general so they will not compare Allah to anything else. فَقَالَ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ ضَلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُهْتَدِينَ. So they use the evidence that verily your Lord is more knowing, but they translated as Allah is knowing of who has been led astray, who has been astray from His path, and He knows who are those who are guided. أي هو عالم بمن ضل عن سبيله وهو عالم بالمهتدين. Meaning He knows who's been misguided and He knows who's guided. قال لأن أعلم اسم تفضيل. The reason why they took this position, they said because أعلم is اسم تفضيل. It's a noun of favoring, favorism, or favoring one over the other. وهو يقتضي اشتراك المفضل والمفضل عليه. And that indicates that there must be some sort of comparison or commonalities between that which is favored and that which was favored over that thing. You see what I'm saying? Meaning you only favor two things when they have things in common. Then you favor one over the other. If they didn't have anything in common, you might not do that. But that's not exactly correct. The Shaykh will say why. But this was the position of some of the scholars. وَهَذَا لَا يَجُوزُ بِالنِّسْبَ إِلَّهِ. They said that you cannot say that about Allah. You cannot, you know, say that Allah is, you can compare Allah to His knowledge to someone else's knowledge and say Allah is more knowledgeable. They were trying to avoid that. لكن عالم اسم فاعل وليس فيه مقارنة ولا تفضيل. But the word عالم, knowing, is just a اسم فاعل. It's on the وزن. It sounds the same as فاعل. عالم, فاعل, you know, قابل, إلى آخره من الكلمات. قادر and what have you. They said this doesn't indicate any favoring. So this is more safe. More safe. فنقول له, the Shaykh said, we tell this person, هذا غلط. This is wrong. This is mistake. This is a mistake. فَاللَّهُ يُعَبِّرُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ وَيَقُولُ أَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتَ تَقُولُ عَالِمُ. Allah Azza wa Jal expresses in the Quran clearly and uses the word أَعْلَمُ. Then you turn around and you say that it means عَالِمُ. وَإِذَا فَسَّرْنَا أَعْلَمُ بِعَالِمُ فَقَدْ حَطَطْنَا مِنْ قَدْرِ عِلْمِ اللَّهِ. And if we explain the word أَعْلَمُ, more knowledgeable or more knowing, as only knowing, then we have reduced or we have belittled the knowledge of Allah. لِأَنَّ عَالِمْ يَشْتَرِكْ فِيهِ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ عَلَى سَبِيلِ الْمُسَوَاتِ. Because knowing is something that anyone may have. Anyone may have, may be knowing of something. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't really make any virtue. There's no special virtue of you knowing something. لَكِنْ أَعْلَمْ مُقْتَدَاهَ أَنَّ لَا يُسَوِيهِ أَحَدْ فِي هَذَا الْعِلْمِ. But when you say more knowing, this indicates that there's no one equal to this person in this knowledge. So if I'm عالم about chemistry, and you're a alim of chemistry, then me and you are the same. me being called a alim does not give me any special status over you because we are both equal. But when you say ana alam, I am more knowledgeable than you in chemistry, this is when the virtue comes. You see what I'm saying? So the Shaykh is saying this is the case with this. This indicates that no one is equal to Allah in knowledge because he is more knowing. You're knowing, he's knowing, Allah is more knowing, rather than saying all of us are knowing. Then that may indicate that we're equal in knowledge. You see? Strong, mashallah. فَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ مِنْ كُلِّ عَالِمُ وَهَذِي أَكْمَلُ فِي الصِّفَةِ بِلَا شَكٍّ. So Allah is more knowledgeable than anyone who has any knowledge. And this is, he said, more befitting, without a doubt. وَنَقُولُ لَهُ. Secondly, we tell him, إِنَّ اللُّغَةَ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ بِالنِّسْبَةِ لِإِسْمِ الْفَاعِلِ لَا تَمْنَعُ الْمُسَاوَاتِ فِي الْوَصْفِ. لكن بالنسبة لإسم التفضيل تمنع المشاركة فيما دل عليه. This is grammar. I'm just gonna bypass it, inshallah. I'm just gonna bypass the grammar as to go to our main subject, inshallah. طيب. So this is the bottom line. That alam is more accurate than saying alim. والوصف الثاني عليكم السلام. So we dealt already with the first one, which is the fact that Allah is more knowledgeable of Himself and others. The second, وأصدق قيل, Allah is more truthful in speech. The Shaykh said, ودليل الوصف الثاني الصدق قوله تعالى ومن أصدق من الله قيل. The evidence for the second thing that Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah mentioned, that Allah is more truthful in speech, is in Surah Al-Nisa, verse 122. Allah Azza wa Jal says, interpretation of the meaning, and who is more truthful in speech than Allah? Who is more truthful than Allah in speech, if you want to translate it word for word? And the answer is, no one. The Shaykh said, أي لا أحد أصدق منه. Again, remember we dealt last week that the question, the information may come in a form of a question in order to indicate negation. And we said this is stronger in the language and more eloquent. So when Allah Azza wa Jalla asks, who is more truthful than Allah in speech? The answer is, as if Allah said, there's no one who's more truthful than Allah in speech. No one. Absolutely no one. لا أحد أصدق منه والصدق مطابقة الكلام للواقع. What does صدق mean? Truthfulness. Truthfulness is when the speech is in harmony, in accordance with the facts. This is what's considered truth. When there's a fact, and the words that express this fact are identical. They are in harmony. They express it perfectly. This is what is considered truth. Otherwise, lying is when other than the reality is said. You know, words that don't describe the reality are used. This is lying. Truthfulness is when they are when they match one another. ولا شيء من الكلام يطابق الواقع كما يطابقه كلام الله سبحانه وتعالى. And there's absolutely nothing, no kind of speech which is more and more accordance with the truth than the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal. No one would know the truth more than Allah. فكل ما أخبر الله به فهو صدق بل أصدق من كل قول. So whatever Allah Azza wa Jal has said is the ultimate truth, rather it is more truthful than any other truth. No one would know the truth more than Allah. Thirdly, ودليل الوصف الثالث, we said eloquence and the clarity in delivering the message. البيان والفصاحة قوله تعالى ومن أصدق من الله حديثا. And the same surah verse 87, Allah Azza wa Jal says interpretation of the meaning, and who is more truthful than Allah in speech. Okay, so both were used. وحسن حديثه يتضمن الحسن اللفظي والمعنوي. The eloquence of the speech of Allah and the truthfulness in it includes both the linguistic, يعني the actual terminology, and the abstract, the meaning behind it. Both are indicated, meaning in the construction of the sentence itself, there's nothing better than that. I mean, that's the ultimate. The Quran, the words of Allah are the ultimate in speech, in terms of the sentence structure and the eloquence in the recitation upon hearing it, grammatically, free from mistakes, free from errors, consistent. You know, the whole Quran, as far as the, you know, this aspect of the language is concerned, grammar and what have you. Also the meaning, and the actual meaning, and the examples that Allah Azza wa Jal strikes in the Quran, which bring clarity, you know, to things that people may not understand. You know, verily the example that of this dunya is like, you know, rain that falls from the sky. It mixes with the vegetation. As soon as the people see it and they enjoy it, a wind comes and it takes it away. And that's the example of the dunya. As soon as one of us enjoys it and he thinks he got a hold of it and he's, you know, living his life, something happens and either you die or you lose your money or you lose your whatever you have and it's gone. Just like the wind will come and take away the vegetation. So this is all included in the eloquence, in the actual sound, the terminology, the physical aspect, يعني, and also in the meaning of the actual verses. طيب. Fourthly, ودليل الوصف الرابع سلامة القصد والإرادة. And the evidence for the first, for the fourth description or quality is the soundness and the correctness of the intent and the will. قوله تعالى, the evidence for that is the statement of Allah عز وجل in Surah An-Nisa, verse 176. يبين الله لكم أن تضلوا. Verily Allah makes it clear for you so you don't go astray. So you will not go astray. Okay? So Allah says, يبين الله لكم. Allah clarifies for you. Bayan, which is to basically make things understood and clear for the listeners. That's why it's called Al-Kitab Al-Mubin. You know, the Quran, the book which brings clarity. It's clear in its content. Right. And another verse that is used in Surah An-Nisa, verse 26, interpretation of the meaning, or the Arabic verse, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَكُمْ وَيَهْدِيَكُمْ سُنَنَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Interpretation of the meaning, verily Allah wants, or Allah Azza wa Jal wants to clarify for you and to guide you to the ways of those who have come before you. The sunan is the ways, because there's, you know, the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is, when it's used in this context, it means his way of life. And the sunnah in general, sunnatullah, the way of Allah, means the way of things are done. That's what sunnah means linguistically. فاجتمع في كلام الله الأوصاف الأربعة التي توجب قبول الخبر. So in the speech of Allah, all four qualities exist and unite in order to make it compulsory to accept the information. All four exist. Allah knows himself better. So when Allah Azza wa Jalla describes himself with something, me and you cannot come and say otherwise. Allah is more truthful in speech. This Quran is the truth. So you cannot reject the truth with something that you may not know. Allah is more eloquent. It's clear. Clarity is in the actual speech for you to understand. الرحمن وعلى العرش استوى. The most merciful rose above the throne. It's understood. And fourthly, the intent. This book is to guide you. Allah made it a source of guidance. So in it will be guidance, not misguidance, not confusion, not misunderstanding or what have you. There are verses that are fixed, muhkam, that are without a doubt the source of guidance for the believers who are sound in their hearts and who don't have any zayd. Because there are people who have deviance, and they will get some verses which may carry more than one meaning, and they try to use them as an evidence for their misunderstood or misguidance of other fixed verses. Like those who say, for example, some of the Christians may tell you that Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّا نَحْنُ. We say this is an indication that the Trinity is correct. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost is in your Quran. Otherwise, why is there we? And the reality is, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ is conclusive. We is, we know, the royal we, not the number, not the plural of numbers. It's the plural of royalty, which, you know, of greatness, which belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ultimately. So these are fixed verses that they don't take away. The same concept of that Allah is above his creation, as you will see, they will use some verses that says that Allah is with you wherever you are. If there are three, then Allah is the fourth. If there are four, then Allah is the fifth. So they say this verse means that Allah must be with us. And they get this verse, which may carry more than one meaning, to negate all the verses which clearly express that Allah Azza wa Jalla is above his creation. أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ. Do you feel safe that the one who is above the heavens? You know, clear. هُوَ هُوَ الْقَاهِرُ فَوْقَ عِبَادِهِ. And he is the irresistible over his servants. Folk. يعني, it's very clear. But anyways, we will see as we continue with the book how these issues are to be understood. So all four qualities exist in the speech of Allah. So then we must accept. This is all preparing us for what will come next. Why are we supposed to take the apparent meaning of the Quran? All this, by the way, is for something that is very natural, which is accepting the apparent meaning of the Quran. Believe it or not, this whole book is only to establish this point. Because there are people, Muslims, who refuse to take the apparent meaning of the book. They like to have hidden meanings, or secretive meanings, or meanings that only some people understand, so you must take it from them. The whole issue is about not accepting the apparent meaning of the verses of the Quran and the narrations of the Prophet ﷺ. This is an introduction to this reality, why we must accept it as it is, unless we have an evidence that indicates otherwise, which we will deal with later inshallah. طيب. The Shaykh said, وَإِذَا كَانَ كَذَلِكَ فَإِنَّهُ يَجِبُ أَن نَقْبَلَ كَلَامَهُ عَلَى مَا هُوَ عَلَيْهِ. If the matter is as such, which is all four qualities exist in the speech of Allah, then we must accept the speech of Allah as it is, as it indicates. وَأَلَّا يَلْحَقَنَا شَكٌّ فِي مَدْلُولِهِ. And we should not have any doubt regarding that which these verses indicate. لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَتَكَلَّمْ بِهَذَا الْكَلَامِ لِأَجْلِ إِضْلَالِ الْخَلْقِ. The Shaykh said, because Allah Azza wa Jal did not speak with this speech in order to misguide the creation. We know that already. Because Allah says, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It's hudan. بَلْ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ وَيَهْدِيَهُمْ. Rather, Allah has said this speech in order to clarify things for them and to guide them. وَصَدَرَ كَلَامُ اللَّهِ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ. And that speech of Allah was expressing Allah Himself. It was given us description and qualities of Allah. أو عن غيره عن أعلم القائلين. وصدر كلام الله عن نفسه أو عن غيره عن أعلم القائلين. And the speech is from Allah about Himself or others. And He is the most knowing. He is the most knowledgeable of anyone who is to address any issue. If Allah was to address any issue, no one knows the affairs more than Allah. The knowledge that we have is from Allah. يعني no one has knowledge because of himself. No one is special, born wallah, a genius. Every single thought that we think of is by Allah. If Allah wills, you cannot think. I cannot think. You cannot speak. I cannot speak. You cannot even drink a cup of water unless Allah wills it. So at the end of the day, it's all from Allah. So no one is more knowledgeable than Allah. وَلَا يُمْكِنُ أَنْ يَعْتَرِيَهُ خِلَافَ الصِّدْقِ. And it's impossible that anything that is opposing to the truth may be included in the speech of Allah. It's impossible. وَلَا يُمْكِنُ أَنْ يَكُونَ كَلَامًا عَيْبًا غَيْرَ فَصِيحٍ. And it is impossible for the speech to be weak, you know, to be weak and you know, lack, or if it's impossible for the speech to lack eloquence. It's impossible for the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وكلام الله لو اجتمعت الإنس والجن على أن يأتوا بمثله لما استطاعوا. And the speech of Allah is in such a way where even if the jinn and ins were to come together to bring something like it, they will not be able to do so. فإذا اجتمعت هذه الأمور الأربعة في الكلام وجب على المخاطب القبول بما دل عليه. If all four qualities are included in the speech, then it becomes compulsory upon the one who's being addressed with the speech to accept whatever that speech indicates. مثال ذلك. An example. قوله تعالى مخاطبا إبليس. The statement of Allah to Iblis, the father of the shayateen, the father of the devils, as it comes in a narration that he has his throne on the water and he sends his expeditions to go and misguide the people. The one comes to him and say, oh, I made this guy steal, I made this guy. He said, it doesn't matter. The one of them will come, he say, I stayed behind him until he divorced his wife. Then he tell, come here. He will give him a hug, hold him. Hey, you the special one. You really my son. The one who gets a person to divorce his wife. This is to know the danger of this. Because the household is, you know, the shayateen is always trying to make problems between you and your wife. And this is a very dangerous zone, because based on this divorce, a lot of people are affected. Both families, the individuals, the children, you know, a number of things. So this is a real victory for the shaitan. Bringing divorce, that's not like any little trivial thing. This is a major accomplishment. So anyways, the hadith mentions that the shayateen are the children of Iblis. لعنة الله عليه. So Allah عز وجل told him, what prevented the verse is ما منعك أن تسجد لما خلقت بيدي. سورة صاد verse 75. It says, interpretation of the meaning in English, what prevented you from prostrating to that which I created with my two hands? يدي, which is dual. يد is singular. Okay? And أيدي is, or أيادي is plural, a number of hands. يدان or يدي here, because the ألف نون cannot come here because of the باء which came before it, another grammar issue. Regardless, is dual. Dual. Two of them. Two of them. And the Prophet ﷺ said, وكلتا يديه يمين. Both the hands of Allah are right, according to the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال قائل, a person will say, في هذه الآية إثبات يدين لله عز وجل يخلق بهما من شاء فثبتهما. A person will say, this verse indicates that Allah عز وجل has two hands, and He creates with them whatever He wills, and He confirms them because He's reading the verse. Allah wants to guide you. Allah knows more about Himself. Allah is more truthful in speech, more eloquent, telling you that He told Iblis, why didn't you prostrate to that which I created with my two hands?
What
about? Huh? Verse 75. لأن كلام الله صادر عن علم وصدق. The speech of Allah is based on knowledge, truthfulness. وكلامه أحسن الكلام. His speech is the best of speech. وأفصحه وأبينه, the most eloquent, the most clear. ولا يمكن أن لا يكون له يدان. لكن أراد من الناس لا يمكن أن لا يكون له يدان, لكن أراد من الناس أن يعتقدوا ذلك فيه. It is impossible that Allah does not have two hands, but then He will say in the Quran that He does. You see what I'm saying? It's impossible that Allah doesn't have hands, and He mentions in the verse that He told Iblis, why didn't you prostrate to that which I created with my two hands? Because if you say that, then you have accused Allah of the worst things. First, it's not truth, because Allah said something that is not in accordance with the truth according to these people who are misguided. This is very many Muslims, by the way, FYI. They may not know any better. We're not saying that they intentionally misguided. They don't know any better. They have not received the education. And ourselves, until we learn these things, we didn't know either. Speaking of myself, first, from where I came from, nobody discusses these things. So of course we didn't know. But now that we know, this is another position. For those that don't know, we educate them. But in reality, when you say that, you are saying that Allah is lying. Because the truth is, He doesn't have hands according to you, but the Quran says that He does. And the Quran is no longer guidance, it's misguidance. Because it's giving you false information. And Allah is not eloquent in His speech, because He's using words that are not real. And you know, you've just destroyed the whole thing. And you're saying that Allah doesn't know Himself because He said something about Himself, and in reality He doesn't have it. So all these are included as soon as a person negates or denies the apparent meaning of the Quran. Rather, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah say we believe, but we stop. How? What kind? The way the Allahu A'lam. We don't laysa kamithlihi shay. There's nothing like Allah. Don't sit there try to imagine no hands. You will never be able to do it. Your brain was not put together to be able to imagine this particular image. This is something that is beyond human perception, so you leave that alone. That's all we do. We don't deny what Allah says, and we don't turn around and make Allah Azza wa Jalla like a human being. We take the middle path as it is expected of us. We confirm the Quran, and we stop where we are expected to stop. That which is beyond us, we don't speak about it with no knowledge. Because if you say something about these hands without knowledge, then you are speaking about Allah with no knowledge. And Allah made this among the major sins. وَأَن تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And that you say about Allah that which you have no knowledge about. So this is where we stop. طيب. وَلَوْ فَرَضَ هَذَا لَكَانَ مُقْتَدَاهُ أَنَّ الْقُرْآنَ ضَلَالٍ. And if we assume that Allah Azza wa Jal said that He has hands, while in reality He doesn't, then that means that the Quran is misguidance. The Quran is a source of misguidance. حَيْثُ جَاءَ بِوَصْفِ اللَّهِ بِمَا لَيْسَ فِيهِ. Because it brought a description of Allah that he does not have. وهذا ممتنع. This is impossible. فإذا كان كذلك, if it is so, وجب عليك أن تؤمن بأن الله تعالى, بأن لله تعالى يدين اثنتين خلق بهما آدم عليه السلام. If this is the case, then it becomes obligatory upon you to believe that Allah Azza wa Jalla has two hands in which He created Adam, peace be upon him, with them. Because that's what Allah said in the Quran. وإذا قلت المراد بهما النعمة والقدرة, as some Muslims said. They said what is intended by that is bounty and ability. That's what is intended by hands. Not hands, hands, but it is a metaphor. It's a word used to indicate bounty and ability, but the word hand was used. The Sheikh said, قلنا لا يمكن أن يكون هذا المراد. We will say this is impossible, that this is what is intended. إلا إذا اشترأت على ربك, unless you have the nerve to speak, يعني to go against your Lord. ووصفت كلامه بضد الأوصاف الأربعة التي قلنا. And you have the nerve to describe the speech of Allah with something against the four qualities that we just established earlier, which is Allah knows more about Himself, more truthful in His speech, more eloquent than what have you. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله. فنقول هل الله عز وجل حينما قال بيدي عالم بأن له يدين. So we say, did Allah عز وجل at the time of this verse being revealed, when He said بيدي with my two hands, doesn't he know better that he has these hands? فسيقول هو عالم. He will say yes, he knows. Allah is more knowing. فنقول هل هو صادق. We say is Allah truthful. فسيقول هو صادق بلا شك. He's truthful without a doubt. ولا يستطيع أن يقول هو غير عالم أو غير صادق. He will not be able to say no, Allah is not truthful or Allah is not knowledgeable. ولا أن يقول عبر بهما وهو يريد غيرهما عيا وعزا. Or we cannot say that Allah wanted that, but he was unable to use the right terminology because of deficiency or lack of eloquence. We cannot say that either. That person would not make that statement either. ولا أن يقول أراد من خلقه أن يؤمنوا بما ليس فيه من الصفات إضلالا لهم. And you cannot say, he will not say that Allah Azza wa Jal expected his creation to believe in some attributes of him which he really doesn't have, as a form of misguidance and to misguide them. فنقول له إذا ما الذي يمنعك أن تثبت لله اليدين. So we tell this person, يا أخي, what is preventing you from affirming the two hands for Allah? What is holding you from doing that? فاستغفر ربك وتوب إليه. Seek forgiveness from your Lord and repent to Him. وقل آمنت بما أخبر الله به عن نفسه. And say to yourself, I believe whatever Allah has said about Himself in the Quran. لأنه أعلم بنفسه وبغيره. Because Allah is more knowledgeable about Himself and others. وأصدق قيلا, Allah is more truthful in speech. وأحسن حديثا, Allah is more eloquent and more clear in his speech. وأتم إرادة من غيره أيضا. Allah has the best intent from anyone else, which is to guide the creation. ولهذا أتى المؤلف رحمه الله بهذه الأوصاف الثلاثة ونحن زدنا الوصف الرابع. He said this is why the مؤلف, the author of the book, Ibn Taymiyyah رحمه الله, brought these three qualities and we added a fourth one from our own, which is that Allah's intent is to guide the people. وهو إرادة البيان للخلق وإرادة الهداية لهم, which is wanting clarity for the creation and guidance for them. لقوله تعالى يريد الله ليبين لكم ويهديكم سنن الذين من قبلكم. Based on the statement of Allah which we mentioned earlier, interpretation of the meaning, verily Allah wants to clarify things for you and to guide you to the ways of those who have come before you. هذا حكم ما أخبر الله به عن نفسه بكلامه الذي هو جامع للكلمات الأربعة في الكلام. He said this is the judgment and the ruling of Allah pertaining you by Allah's speech Himself, which is this verse, which includes all four qualities that we just mentioned, that were just aforementioned. The fact that Allah Azza wa Jal knows better, He wants to guide us, He's more truthful in speech and more eloquent in His expressions as well. أَمَّا مَا أَخْبَرَتْ بِهِ الرُّسُلُ. This is as far as the first. Then Ibn Taymiyyah رحمه الله said, فَقَالَ الْمُؤَلِّفْ ثُمَّ رُسُلُهُ صَادِقُونَ مَصْدُوقُونَ بِخِلَافِ الَّذِي يَقُولُونَ عَلَيْهِ مَا لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Furthermore, the messengers of Allah are truthful ones and accepted and believed to be truthful, unlike those who speak about Allah without knowledge. Because what is the source of this deen? The Quran and the Sunnah. And during any time, any prophet, it's whatever revelation they receive from Allah and the teachings of their prophet during that time. So whatever Allah said in His revelation, or whatever the prophet that Allah has chosen from among His creation said about Allah, is equal for us, because these messengers were chosen by Allah, and they will say nothing but the truth. And this is relevant to the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which we will deal with as well. So every prophet with his respective people, they were chosen by Allah. So their speech about Allah is to be taken into consideration as the truth, because they have this quality of saying nothing but the truth about Allah. قَوْلُهُ ثُمَّ رُسُلُهُ صَادِقُونَ مَصْدُوقُونَ الصادق, the truthful one, is Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. This is one of his names, one of his kunyas, nicknames. الْمُخْبِرُ بِمَا طَابَقَ الْوَاقَعَ. The صادق is the one who speaks the truth which is in accordance to the reality of something. فَكُلُّ الرُّسُلْ صَادِقُونَ بِمَا أَخْبَرُوا بِهِ. All the messengers are truthful regarding that which they spoke about. Any statement of the messenger is the truth, of course, in the context of the Sharia, in the context of the deen. Because there may have been some things that the messengers have said that were not exactly relevant to the deen. Such as the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, when he seen him doing a certain thing to the palm trees, and he told them that, you know, you may not want to do that. So they did that, and then the tree did not produce as many fruits. So when they came and told him, he said, you know better about the affairs of your dunya. You know more about this world. Whatever I tell you about the deen, that's the stuff that there's no questioning about. The affairs of the dunya is a whole other issue. Just in case you come across this hadith in the future and you get a shubha or a misconception, this is not the case. Affairs of the deen, speaking about Allah more specifically, this is protected by Allah. They will not say but the truth, and nothing will remain for us but the truth. طيب. ولكن لا بد أن يثبت السند إلى الرسل عليهم السلام. But the thing we have different from the Quran is that we need to confirm the chain of narration. The narration being attributed to the prophets. If so. فإذا قالت اليهود قال موسى كذا وكذا. If the Jews come and say Moses عليه السلام said such and such, فلا نقبل, we will not accept. We will not accept. حتى نعلم صحة سنده إلى موسى عليه السلام. Until we are able to have a chain of narration which confirms this being a statement of موسى عليه الصلاة والسلام. Otherwise people say anything. And this is very common where people speak on behalf of the prophets and the messengers. Very common among the Christians with Jesus. Anything that they want to add to their belief system, they attribute it to Jesus. And not only that, they put it in the Bible. They'll put it in the Bible the next day. And they say, just to a side story here, that a Jew during the time of one of the Khulafa of the Muslims, a Jew came to them, his appearance was good, you know, he seemed to be a respected man, knowledgeable, what have you. So he came to do some business, so they told him, embrace Islam. He said, I'm not gonna embrace Islam. I'm happy with what I have. I'm pleased with my religion. Then they left. He left. He came back a couple of years later, and he was sitting there teaching the people the affairs of the deen, of Islam. So then the leader told him, the ruler, weren't you the same guy who was here a couple of years ago, and we invited you to Islam, and you said you were, you know, good enough, you don't need it? He said, yes. He said, what brought you to Islam? He said, here's what I did. I went and I wrote, I made, he was the one who, you know, what, calligrapher, what do they call them? Right. This, the people who have nice handwriting. I know there's a technical term.
Calligraphy,
right. Calligrapher, I guess. So he went and wrote a version of the Torah, the Old Testament. And he added some verses and he removed some verses. He added, deleted according to what he wants. Two copies. He went to the market. As soon as the people seen this, yalla, they bought it from him ala tool. They bought it from him. Nobody checked. Says the Torah, yalla, ala tool. He did the same thing with the New Testament, you know, the Bible. he made something similar, or the Gospels at least, and he went likewise. As soon as the people seen it, they bought it from him على طول. Then he did the same thing with the Quran, and he went to sell it to the Muslims. They looked at the Quran and said, take your books, we don't need it. So he said, I knew that this book's from Allah. I knew that this book is preserved. The other one, Allah, أي كلام فبش. Business, business. It's business. They're not even concerned. The Muslims said, hold on, man, let me see what you wrote this yourself. Let me make sure that this is authentic. He found some verses, gone some verses, added. He told him, I'm not going to buy this book from you. So the person realized at this point that Islam is the deen of Allah. And this is the book of Allah, and he became a Muslim, then he started teaching. Anyways, it's interesting, and I think it's a true story. I've read it in one of these reliable sources, inshallah. Anywho, so if somebody says, Musa said such and such, we will reject that, unless we can affirm it. And usually nowadays, whenever the Bible is quoted, and we do quote the Bible occasionally, only in terms of things that have been confirmed in the Quran. So if something is attributed to Jesus or Moses or otherwise, or David or Solomon or whatever, and we have something identical in the Quran, then we may assume that this is the truth also. This is among the things that were preserved. If it opposes the Quran, we know this is a lie. If there's nothing in the Quran which accepts or denies, then we will hold the same position. We will not say that this is the truth, and we will not belie it. Because you may say this is falsehood, and it may be truth. And you may believe it, and it may be falsehood. So if you don't have anything in Islam which tells us how to feel regarding these texts, then we are neutral. If Islam says otherwise, we deny them. If Islam affirms, then we say that this may be among the truth, so we quote them accordingly. And this is relevant with the Christians. You may need some biblical verses which clearly prove the Tawheed with the own statements of Jesus. His own statements, not somebody speaking about him, his own words. So when somebody came and asked him, you know, oh good master, what shall I do to enter the eternal life? And he told him, don't call me good. The only one who's good is the one God. But if you want to enter eternal life, if you want salvation, keep the commandments. He didn't tell him, I'm God, I'm good, I'm the son of God, worship me. He said, don't call me good man. Don't give me this divine attribute. The only one who's good is the one God. He didn't tell him, if you want to enter paradise, that I'm going to die on the cross for your sins. He said, keep the commandments. Then if you go in the Bible, what's the first commandment? Jesus said, the first commandment is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. This is all la ilaha illallah. This is Tawheed. Tawheed from the Bible. It's in the Quran. So you may use that with a Christian. Say, look man, whatever you say in this is the same thing we're teaching. So Jesus tells you, don't call me good. And you tell him, no, you're the son of God. You are equal to God. You're part of three. Who are you going to take? The teachings of the priest in church or the Bible? He will tell you, no, the Bible. But this is what the Bible says. You know, you make him realize that what they are, their foundation is weak. And this is sometimes the way. Because sometimes they think you have a religion, Islam, I'm a religion. You find you could keep Islam. It's good for you. This is good for me. So when you invite him to Islam, he does not feel the need to leave his religion and come to you. Unless you shake him off. Say, listen man, you think you're on some strong foundation. Here's a few issues in your belief system. Then he realizes, oh, maybe I'm wrong. Then you show him the beauty and the consistency and the accuracy in Islam. Then this will make it an easier transition for this person to enter Islam. Allahu A'lam. This is just da'wah tips in your da'wah activities, inshallah. طيب. The Shaykh said, وَإِذَا قَالَتِ النَّصَارَى قَالَ عِيسَى كَذَا وَكَذَا. Likewise, if the Christians say, Jesus said such and such, then فَلَا نَقْبَلْ. We will not accept حَتَّى نَعْلَمُ صِحَّةِ السَّنَدِ عِيسَى عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. Until we can confirm the chain of narration, meaning the people who quoted this statement all the way to Jesus, which is impossible right now, basically. وَإِذَا قَالَ قَائِلْ قَالَ مُحَمَّدٌ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ سَلَّمَ كَذَا وَكَذَا فَلَا نَقْبَلْ حَتَّى نَعْلَمْ صَحَّةِ السَّنَدِ إِلَى مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهِ سَلَّمَ. Even if someone says, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said such and such, you don't accept. You do not accept unless you could affirm the authenticity of this particular statement. This is very important because there are many books that are out there. And you see many ads. Sometimes you get emails. Ibrahim knows about all that. Sometimes they hang them on, you know, you come and find something. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whomever goes khuruj for 3 days, it will be like the mujahid in the cause of Allah for 20 years. Say, oh, mashallah. The next day you go on khuruj, jama'at tabligh, Then you come and find this narration man doesn't even exist in the deen. And I've heard many similar things with my own ears. You know, you do ghusl, you get the reward of ghusl for 40 years. And something just beyond, yani something ajeeb. You think this small act of worship, mashallah, I'm going to get all these deeds. But what is this hadith? Who narrated this hadith? Where can I find this hadith? Nothing. It doesn't even exist. It's mawdu', fabricated. But they say that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said such and such and such. So we have to, that's why you have Sahih Bukhari, Muslim, and Tirmidhi, and Nasa'i, and Abu Dawood, and Ibn Majah. That's why you have scholars of hadith. That's after these muhaddithin, you have other scholars who also came and evaluated these narrations and said this is da'if, this is such gharib, this is sahih, ila akhrihi. They also labeled the hadith what is authentic and what is otherwise. So this is a very big field. We cannot just take any statement unless it's a trustworthy person. Even then, we must verify the information. The Quran is done. It's within, it's all, alhamdulillah. But the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ, there are additions. There are fabricated narrations, like the narrations of Surah Yasin. You read some books, if you read these narrations, you will start reading nothing but Yasin. Whomever reads Yasin one time, Allah will forgive him all of his sins. Yasin is for whatever it's read for. Yeah, you read for the intention to become this, it's going to happen to you. Everything has a heart, and the heart of the Quran is Yasin. Whomever, you know these narrations? All of these narrations are fabricated and weak. None of them can be accepted. When they asked this person, why did you do that? He said, I found the people abandoning the book of Allah, so I figured I'll come up with some narrations to encourage the people to read. So they said, Surah Al-Waqi'ah, if you recite it every evening, you will never see poverty. And if you recite Surah Yasin, this will happen to you. All these ahadith cannot be attributed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in any way, shape or form. The ones that are acceptable are known. The end of Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayat Al-Kursi, Surah Al-Fatiha, Surah Al-Ikhlas, Surah Al-Mulk. You know, whoever recites it every night, it will protect him from the punishment of the grave. It will argue on your behalf on the Day of Judgment until it saves you from the fire. These are authentic. Surah Al-Kahf on Jumu'ah, the first 10 verses or the last 10 verses pertaining to the protection from the Dajjal. But Surah Yasin and all of the things around it are fabricated narrations that none of them are authentic. So be careful. Yes. Surah Ar-Rahman also, they have similar things. So you find many people always reciting Surah Yasin, Surah Yasin. They abandon the whole Quran and they focus on Yasin because they think it has this virtue. In reality, it doesn't have this virtue. That's why it's important to have to find a book or a scholar who have authenticated these narrations. What did the Ahlul Hadith, the people of Hadith, say about these narrations? Can they be attributed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not? So we can act accordingly. Otherwise, there's a big field of things that have been attributed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam which are unauthentic. So just be.
So the Prophet,
it's authentic.
On Jumu'ah.
On Jumu'ah, yes, it's authentic. So one hadith says before, during the day, and one says during the night.
Read once.
Yes, there's a hadith that Allah will illuminate light for you from your feet all the way to the heavens. And another narration, Allah will forgive you the sins between that Jumu'ah and the other Jumu'ah plus 3 days. So these are authentic narrations that are attributed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the virtue of Surah Al-Kahf. No one can deny. Surah Al-Mulk, authentic. Surah Al-Ikhlas, authentic. Mu'awidhatan, Falak, Wal-Nas, authentic. The end of Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayat Al-Kursi, Al-Imran Al-Baqarah, that they will come on the Day of Judgment argue on behalf of the one who used to read them. Authentic. Waqi'ah, da'if. The hadith is weak. Dukhan, Surah Yasin. All these are weak narrations. The ones that are authentic are known. Anything extra?
Surah Al-Rahman.
No. Even Surah Ar-Rahman, no.
Surah
Ar-Rahman is big. No. These are very common. Very common. It took us years to realize them. I was reciting Surah Al-Waqi'ah, man, until alhamdulillah, I memorized it. By the grace of Allah, due to recitation, it was my some person's advice. And then I realized later that, that I shouldn't be doing that. But, you know, if you leave it for the sake of Allah, Allah will give you a better in return. They don't think, I'm losing reward, I was reciting Surah Al-Waqi'ah every day. Allah will give you the reward of following the Sunnah. It's all by the hands of Allah. Back home, we had another bid'ah. This bid'ah said, if you lose something, continue to recite Surah Al-Duha. I used to walk around, I would lose my pen, you know, as a student in school, reciting Surah Al-Duha maybe 100 times. وَالْضُحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. What does Al-Duha have to do with losing something? Allahu A'lam. But I did this for Allahu A'lam how long until we realized that there's no asl, there's absolutely no hadith regarding this act of worship that we were doing. Very common among the people. Even now, after the Iqamah. حقا وصدقا وحقا ويقينا لا إله إلا الله محمد. يا شيخ بالله عليك. From where did you get this? This is not from the Sunnah, FYI, for your information. After he calls the Iqamah, you have two options. Either you remain silent, or according to other opinion scholars, you may do the dua of after the adhan. Because they consider the Iqamah as another form of adhan. So you may say, Allahumma rabba hadha da'wat al-tamma wa salata al-qaima ila akhir al-dua. But to say حقا وصدقا ويقينا وإخلاصا وهذا لا إله إلا الله محمد. يا شيخ والله it's not from the sunnah, but it is very common. It's very common. So معلش, don't tell me anything else. This is a طامة كبرى. Something similar can be said about raising the hands after the adhan. After the adhan, the people raise the hand and he make the dua. Another, it's not from the sunnah to raise the hands after at the time. It's a sunnah to raise your hands, but the bid'ah comes in the shape, it comes in the time, it comes in association with another act of worship. So raising the hands in general is the sunnah while making dua. But to associate it with another act of worship at a particular time consistently, this is when you have taken a valid act of worship and put it in the wrong place, so it becomes a bid'ah. Not because the raising the hand is a bid'ah, but the timing in which you are raising your hand is a bid'ah. You see? Very common among the Muslims. Unless you know the sunnah, you will not know. And the funny thing is, if you don't do these things, people will think you're ignorant. That's the other problem now. When you don't do these things, people will think either you don't like the sunnah, or you are ignorant about the sunnah. When in reality, you'll be the only one practicing the sunnah. But this is the مصداقية, this is the manifestation of the hadith of Rasulullah. Islam began as strange and he will go back as being strange. Something similar, and I will conclude that this could be said about the sunnah before Jumu'ah. It is very common now that when the Imam calls the first adhan for the Jumu'ah, people will get up and pray four rak'ahs. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ never prayed those. During his time there was only one adhan, number one. There was no two adhan. This was during Uthman radiallahu anhu, when the two adhan became, when Muslims became large, so they needed to make one call to notify the people, another one for the initiation of the khutbah. There was no narration that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu would pray after the adhan is called. Rather, when he came in and he got on the minbar, said salamu alaykum, then the imam would call the adhan. Then he would give the khutbah ala tul. So there's absolutely no sunnah before Jumu'ah. And this has been discussed by Ibn Taymiyyah and many other scholars in a whole book dealing with this very issue of the Sunnah Qabliyah of Jumu'ah. There's no such thing. What the companions used to do, they would go to the masjid early, like 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, and they would pray a lot of nafila. 2, 4, 6, 8, 12, 20, 50, as much as they want. They continue to pray until the time of Jumu'ah. Some will read the Quran, some will do dhikr, some will remember Allah, some will make dua, some will pray. So you may pray unconditional voluntary prayers. But to have the intention to pray the four rak'ah the same way you do after dhuhr, before dhuhr, every day, during Jumu'ah, there's absolutely no basis for this particular act.
But two rak'ah?
No. If you come in, you pray tahiyyat al-masjid. Hey, but no two rak'ah. Yani if you came in at 10 o'clock, you pray tahiyyat al-masjid, you sat down.
After
then? Khalas, you sit down. Nowadays again, have they called the adhan, everybody will get up and pray but you.
Even Makkah.
Hey, everywhere. People will think you don't pray the sunnah. But you, Allah knows, you are sitting down because you are living the sunnah. But because ignorance has spread among the Muslims, to the people who may not know any better will think this person doesn't pray the sunnah. Well, it's no good, man, it's no good. Although you are applying the sunnah and what they're doing has no basis in the sunnah. Again, Islam began as strange and it will go back to being strange, so give glad tidings to the strangers. You will be strange if you try to live the sunnah in every way, shape, or form, inevitably. But if you want to get the glad tidings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, we might as well join the crowd. Let's be strange, because the people will never be happy.
But after Jummah, 4 rakah, 2 rakah.
They say that Ibn Umar mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he prayed in the masjid, he will pray 4. If he prayed at home, he prays 2.
2 in masjid, 2 in home.
No. If he was to pray the sunnah, if he remained in the masjid and prayed the sunnah in the masjid, he would pray 4 rakahs.
2 taslim or 1 taslim?
No, it doesn't mention. But the better 2 taslim.
Okay. 2 plus 2.
Okay.
Yes. If he prayed at home, he would pray 2 rakahs.
So he will not perform in masjid.
Well, if he did, he would pray 4. Okay. That's how Ibn Umar, as far as I remember mentioning, quoting it. This is how he explained it. Of course, in general, praying the sunnah at home is what is expected, not at the masjid. It is very common nowadays, specifically the one after the salah. Maybe before the salah, it may be difficult to pray at home because you may miss the iqamah. So you come at the adhan time, and you know, they call the adhan for dhuhr, you pray 4 rakah. But the sunnah is that you pray the 2 after dhuhr at home, not in the masjid. And this is much more rewarding than the one you pray in the masjid. And there are many, many narrations about the virtue of praying the sunan, the voluntary prayers at your house, not making it a grave. And Allah would put blessing in the salah you pray at home. And it's better than the one you pray in the masjid. That's another sunnah that we may abandon nowadays. Yeah.
Regarding sunnah on the Friday, in my country, you know what they do? After giving the khutbah, they give time to pray 2 rakah. And then after that, then he will give the final part of the
khutbah,
that is in Arabic.
No,
after Adhan, they give time before starting
khutbah. From India? Yeah,
India.
No, they have, you know, they have khutbah in Arabic only, you know. The translation they give before the
khutbah. I heard. They made me do this in America. The brothers invited me to give khutbah in one of the masajid. And I came in and the khatib was on the minbar. And I'm coming, I'm the khatib. What is this brother doing, man? It turned out that, you know, they make a person do it in Arabic. Then I came and then as soon as I got in, after 5 minutes, people started telling me the time. I'm like, yes, Sheikh, you bring me here to give a khutbah. 5 minutes, you expect me to go down the minbar? Because he's already been given the khutbah for, I don't know, 40 minutes and they have to go back to work. So I'm coming there wasting their time. So it was one of these strange occasions. But
just to explain what happens in India, first they give it in Urdu, local language.
Aywa.
In general khutbah.
Nah.
And after that he says, go and pray 2 rakah sunnah. And then he comes back and gives the Arabic khutbah, which is, then after that the prayer starts.
I see. Well, see, they must have a basis. If they have any, yani athar, anything, hadith, and they're following a position, alhamdulillah. But if they don't have anything,
you don't know.
No, you know, they think that
the khutbah
should be in Arabic.
No. Hey. No, they